All right, welcome everyone. We're Semblance of Sanity. I'm Caleb.
I'm Jacob.
And we're here for Bojack Horseman,
Season 6, Episode 10. Figure It Out.
Situation
is... Oh, boy.
Wild.
Like, we thought that
oh
it was...
Oh, dear, oh, dear, oh, dear.
God damn it. God damn it.
It's so bad. It's so bad. I'm sorry. Oh, my God. We have Bojack being told by... Yeah. Oh, by Charlotte... just figure it out. I don't care. The reporters are here.
Yep.
Stop this.
Uh-huh.
I don't want, you know, I don't want her getting brought up into any of your shit.
Right. I can't wait to see how Bojack goes about trying to deal with this.
Yeah.
We
had our theories from the previous episode.
We had our theories, you know, and I think there is a decent shot that things will not go in the absolute worst possible way
immediately.
but it's gonna, like, I'm
it's gonna spiral.
I feel optimistic about the way in which this is going to go bad, because
in
this,
before our sperm whale guy gets onto the TV and says breaking news, oh, did God. Bojack, and then
and then he'll probably make some like terrible pun or something,
very horrible pun, even worse
don't...
than my puns.
I
know that's impossible, but
yeah. This will be interesting. And how will Bojack's friends respond when it's like, hey,
so yeah
mm-hmm.
So all right, y'all, without further ado, let's get into this. Oh, all right, we got an organ. Oh, yes. Yes, the baby humans.
Uh-huh.
Oh, you gotta try Chicago-style baked potato.
Look at this. Fork and knife individually wrapped, so much plastic. Or the Chicago baby humans are owned by the brother of the CEO of Plastico, and we are thereby complicit in this incestuous money laundering scheme that's, oh, by the way, killing the planet. What are you gonna do, right?
That's amazing. The little banner.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. Ah, the rat race behind her.
Oh, nice.
That's funny.
Yeah.
Wow. Nice. And then,
good morning,
news about Bojack.
Want to go try and hit a Chicago style museum?
I really have to work on my book. Next time.
Great. I've made my romantic offer. I've officially been a good boyfriend. I will now retreat to our living room to play video games all day.
Me! He's me! Oh my God!
For real, for real. Hey, you got this, girl. You got this.
Yeah.
But you might also be getting some new material soon.
Bruh.
A lot of new material.
Bruh.
Mm-hmm.
Hello, I am Diane, and I am a young girl living in Boston, and ever since I was that, I wanted to write good things that were good. This is not good. Fix this late.
Yes.
As your father, I am very unsupportive. Come up with examples of dad being unsupportive.
Girls from high school.
Hey, I'm Chrissy Keating. Can you use my real name?
This is sometimes how the writing process works, yeah.
Any of this is correct.
Put me in your book. Remember I gave you that salad bowl?
Then I broke the bowl. Answer your bowl.
Whoa.
Kept falling apart like our marriage.
Is that something? Is any of this anything?
Answer your phone. I'm calling you right now.
What?
If I had my shitty students do a night of scenes here at the end of the semester, would you come see it?
How can I resist?
How's that book
going?
I'm actually at the mall writing it now. I couldn't focus at home, and this is the only place I could sit and work for 10 hours. All I need to do now is actually write my book, but I can't seem to figure out what the book is.
You gonna put any stories about me in there?
I think I've written about you enough.
But no one else is as good at it.
I'm sure someone will rise to the occasion.
Well.
So far, we've been able to contact 3 of the 4 Penny Carsons listed in New Mexico. Baxter, there's nowhere I'd rather be than on our honeymoon.
Oh no, we're just gonna do all the build-up to...
Mm-hmm, yeah.
Figure it out.
Oh, why?
Cuckoo! Cuckoo!
Oh, sorry, I didn't mean...
Kisses, Baxter, dear. It appears we've found our deer.
This is... this is...
Oh, no.
This is incredible, but...
I grew up in Boston town because
you don't
my father,
need it to be a biography, though.
Live in Boston. That's not right English. I'll fix it later.
I really understand what it's like to grow up in Boston. You actually have to go back 250 years to the
what?
Boston Tea Party.
I'm teabagging in the harbor.
Oh, no freaking way. Go past.
Unrelated.
Stop. Yes.
What's wrong with your head, Dee Dee?
The idea behind the...
Oh, my God.
We have to look at trauma.
We totally have to look at trauma.
What?
There's a spring sale, 40% off.
Security still can't figure out who's stealing wallets. Like, I bet my life it's that hag Devin from the hair crimper cart.
Oh my God, yes, that theory is beast.
Sorry.
We forgive you.
But you know the story about Gemberly, right? What they found in her locker?
We forgive you.
Pardon me, I need another size. But I can't seem to find a number on the tag.
We don't see size here at Trauma.
Okay, but can you help me?
I think it would help if you figured out why you need to put a number on your body and let me get back to this mystery.
Hello?
Great news! Birthday Dad premiered last
Grand
night
Dad,
to 0.006, which is the
wow.
biggest network hit since the inventor of blood-scented perfume went on Shark Tank and got her arm bitten off. My company's running like gangbusters.
Is gangbusters a slur of some sort? Can we still say gangbusters?
I'll look into it.
My work-life balance is on point. What would make my work-life balance even on point here? And it hit me. More work.
Right! Yeah.
See how your book's doing.
I'm still kind of figuring out what the is of it is, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
Think it's about trauma.
Trauma?
Or damage. Holes that break and then the cracks get filled with gold and then they're even more beautiful. Maybe it's like that. We've all been damaged, but it's good damage because it makes us more who we are. Is that anything?
Good damage. I like it. Send me the pages and I'll get them to the publisher.
Okay, but no hurry?
No. Hurry.
Yeah. Ah, shit.
What can I get? Some information with a side order of revelation. We're looking to identify an associate of Sarah Lynn.
Sarah Lynn? Is this about Bojack?
Is it about Bojack?
I don't know anything about it, okay? I haven't seen Bojack in years. Or Sarah Lynn. But you have seen them. I'm gonna go ask the kitchen about your pasta.
Wait, that's the fella from the police report who found the dead girl in the planetarium.
Found the dead girl? Are you smelling what I'm smelling?
Oh.
If he was also with her at the AA meeting.
Well, then why wouldn't he mention it to the police?
You're starting to make more sense than a change machine.
Yeah, speaking of sense, what happened to Penny?
Oh, poop! Our scoop's thrown the coop!
Go, go, go! Gotta stay in the loop.
Oh my God.
So in a way, that salad bowl
Meanwhile.
Was me. And the cracks were also me. Ugh, it sucks. I'm sorry. I can't remember what happened when, and I keep getting distracted.
Just maybe don't do a biography.
Yeah.
But isn't it worth it? I mean, you've been feeling so much better, right?
Clearer, but also so foggy.
You feel clear and foggy.
I don't know, because of the fog.
Hey, stick with it.
With the writing or the fog?
Both.
Maybe you gotta live in there for a little bit.
Start at the beginning. I'm a baby.
Hey!
Great to grow up in a comfortable upper middle class home. Love.
I didn't grow up surrounded by love. That's the problem.
Name one example of me being a bad dad.
How you made me lose on purpose at Boggle, so my brothers would think they were, quote, wicked smarter than a girl. Constantly. I just can't express.
Is this what your book is? Just you complaining?
This book is like bore me with a spoon, Diane. You know the story about Gemberly, right? What they found in her locker? It was a note from the thief saying where all the wallets were hidden.
What? What is this? I'm trying to write about my childhood trauma. I'm Ivy.
I'm
my
the girl
mom
that
and I
was
moved to Chicago from Southern California. My dad died, and we needed a new start.
Yeah.
Malls are fun. Or beast, which is slang that young people like me say.
Ivy Tran, right? I need help. Someone's been filching onesies by the twosies from the fourth floor baby hole, and if I don't figure out who done it, my manager's gonna mount my head on the wall.
Managers can be very annoying. I'll take the case. I'm Vietnamese American.
Beast.
Wow.
Ivy Tran, food court detective.
Wow. Actually, like
something.
To be a profound treatise on
damage. No, no, no. Stop.
I can't
Stop.
Even access my damage. I'm too hopped up on goofberries. I need to go to a dark place, and I can't get there. When I'm with you, when we're out, I feel good. I feel happy. The minute I sit down to write...
Hey, you were having trouble writing this book when you were depressed.
You're
having trouble now that you're not depressed. Possible that you just...
What, that I'm just a shitty writer?
No.
No. That you don't want to write this book. Yep, yep, exactly.
Hard. But that means it's worthwhile.
No.
Good things are hard.
No.
I'm not writing the mall-related mysteries of Ivy Tran.
What not?
Yeah, yeah.
I'm going to tell you what I always tell my good friend Eileen.
Don't do it.
Eileen, come on.
Yeah, yeah. Come on, Eileen. She liked that. She liked that.
Guns, please.
I soft-pitched your book to Brad Pitt's company Plan B and Craig Bierko's company Plan C.
Wow.
Very excited about the movie adaptation.
What movie adaptation?
I don't know. A new Robin Hood adaptation. No, Diane, the adaptation of your book. Actually, come to think of it, a new Robin Hood sounds pretty good. Judah?
Maybe from Maid Marian's point of view?
Directed by Sofia Coppola?
I'll try Rebecca Ferguson's agent.
Oh, my God.
That actually sounds fun.
Really responded to your pitch about damage.
It wasn't a pitch.
All the little Dianes out there just waiting to see their story on the big screen.
It wouldn't be better if I wrote something more fun?
Diane, sad is the new fun. Sad is what makes it you. But they want to see pages. So do what you do and get me that sad.
She's booked for the next year developing a new Peter Pan from Wendy's point of view. And Rebecca's doing a limited series about the female ticket taker at the cinema where Batman's parents got shot.
That was incredible.
Nguyen.
Yeah.
No one?
Wow. No one. Yeah. That. Wow.
Okay.
Hey, Pen. What's wrong?
Nothing. I just thought I'd stop by. Why are you grilling me?
Slow down.
Something happened at work.
Something? Or someone?
If you didn't want to be followed, you should have been more judicious with the turn signal.
Can I help you?
Paige Sinclair.
Yeah. This is trespassing.
And I'm Max.
Okay.
We're circling a story on the last days of Sarah Lynn, and we're trying to nail down a timeline. We think your Bojack Horseman may have played a part.
I think you should go.
Well, it was worth a try.
Did see Sarah Lynn. Right before she died.
Oh, it was very worth a try.
She came to Oberlin. With Bojack.
Bojack came to Oberlin?
And what happened?
I saw them and told Bojack to leave. That's it.
Were they intoxicated?
Is Bojack ever not?
Excuse us, we are just about to sit down to dinner.
Do you think Bojack got Sarah Lynn drunk? We should tell them about Maddie.
No!
Who's Maddie?
My best friend in high school. And he bought her booze before the prom, and then she got alcohol poisoning.
What's this, a party? Did you guys forget to invite Kyle?
If you think of anything else, please do give us a call.
Can you keep it down, please? I couldn't sleep. I need to write.
Okay, right on.
Sound-canceling headphones.
Yeah, yeah.
Hey, how was the writing?
What do you mean?
You were gonna write today.
Oh, is the day over? I was just thinking thoughts.
Are you all right?
Oh
my God.
Yep.
It's okay.
Maybe you can just go back to bed and you can work in the morning.
No, now. I'm 17 years old. I live in Boston.
Problem is you always blame other people, Dee Dee.
I know.
Who's a good baby?
Pages from our beautiful celebrities, such as Dr. Jamie.
Focus. I'm trying to get to the truth.
I think you're afraid of the truth.
Are you? You know, one of those stupid pop culture analogies I'm always doing?
Think you're a beautiful salad bowl? Conceited much, am I right?
You blame everyone else for all your problems, but you're the one constant here. Go Pats.
You're right.
What is going on?
There's a heaviness on my chest. I stopped taking my meds.
Why?
Because I'm terrible. Oh. I'm a stupid person. I deserve this.
No, you're not a stupid person. But you can't just...
I want to die.
You're going to withdraw.
Do I have to just be on drugs forever now? It's the only thing that matters.
Now, that's not true.
I'm sorry. I'm so stupid. I'm sorry.
It's okay. Take your pills. All right? Then, when you even out, we can talk about trying something else.
Just want to be a beautiful salad bowl.
You are.
Yeah. Just...
How are you doing?
A little better today.
Yeah.
And I wanted to say sorry.
For what?
I don't know.
You said the book's the only thing that matters.
Don't be mad.
Don't be mad about what?
What you have to remember is that you were in a really dark place, and the pressure from Princess Carolyn wasn't helping. I thought if I could get her off your back for a few days...
What did you do?
I sent her the Ivy Tran food court detective pages.
What?
Made an executive decision.
He did the thing.
Yeah.
Hello.
Loved it.
No.
I love the protagonist. I love the world. I love that it wasn't your sad memoir about your boring life.
What happened to sad is the new fun?
I didn't know you could write this fun. Done. I slipped the pages to a few studios. This has franchise potential.
I'm saying is that it doesn't because that's not the book I'm writing.
I'm hearing a maybe.
I'm not.
Ugh. Uh-huh.
Are we going to have a Boston style fight now?
Hey.
Here's a mystery.
Yeah.
Why are you What's so that? Sad, Core? Just be fun and popular like me.
I don't know how.
I'm clever and free-spirited and a little bit Damn. Sardonic, but not so much that it's off-putting. That's the way to be.
It's not that easy.
Jeez.
Yeah, I know. But wouldn't it be nice if it was?
Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah.
Where's Princess Carolyn?
She said we should save her a seat. You still working on that memoir?
Well, funny story about that.
Yeah.
Oh, love when stories start like that. Ooh, you should put this one in your book.
Oh.
Hello.
Wow. We're going to tell the story, but from Diane's perspective.
Hmm.
We have to talk.
Shh, Diane, don't be rude to the actors. For most of them, this will be the height of their career.
I'm proud.
True.
The kid clapping.
I love PC so much.
This episode of Birthday Dad is an all-timer.
Penny.
Oh, my gosh.
I wanted to get something.
Oh, boy.
I don't feel good about what happened with those reporters.
It's okay.
We didn't tell them everything.
Yeah.
It's all really confusing.
Charlotte, Birthday Dad just got trapped in a leap year. How's he gonna wiggle out of this one?
In a minute, honey.
Stuff happened to us. He's still out there.
Penny.
If we can get the word out,
won't be just him in the story. It'll be you and me. The mistakes we made, mistakes I made, that I will never forgive myself.
Oh. We'll have been for something. You know, it won't just be this thing to feel bad about forever.
You don't know what's going to happen with the story once it's out there.
Wow.
You have no power over it. And you just got your panic attacks under control. Just think about it, okay? Give it a couple days, and then if you still want to talk to them, you can call them.
So.
Okay. Thank you.
So,
you want to stay and watch Birthday Dad? Stay the night?
No, I should go.
I love you.
I love you, too.
Oh, shit.
So she then calls Bojack.
Yeah.
To get the reporters to go.
Oh, shit.
Whoa.
That's...
Don't go over the dateline, Birthday Dad, because then it won't be your birthday anymore.
Damn.
Thank you.
Wait, this is so...
Huh.
But I want to see if there's an after credit scene.
There is.
Wait a minute. Yeah. Princess Carolyn...
I understand. You're trying to be helpful in your own pushy, self-absorbed way.
Oh, thank you. When I was reading it, I could tell you were having fun.
Yeah, but I'm not writing a book to have fun. If I don't write my book of essays now, I never will.
So, don't write your book of essays.
I have to. If I don't, that means that all the damage I got isn't good damage. It's just damage. And all those years I was miserable was for nothing. I could have been happy this whole time, and popular, and had good parents. Is that what you're saying? What was it all for?
I don't know, Diane. All I know is that this book about the girl detective is fun. I like thinking that my daughter could grow up in a world with books like that. Or if my daughter's not a reader, a lucrative film adaptation.
I thought that everything, all the abuse and neglect, it somehow made me special.
Wow.
And I decided that one day I would write something that would make little girls like me feel less alone. If I can't write that book,
then maybe write this other book. Maybe this book does that too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, everybody's leaving.
Princess Carolyn?
What reporters?
Bojack?
I swear I don't know what you're talking about.
Great show.
What? Huh?
Oh. Oh, no! Bojack!
Wow!
Okay.
Amazing episode, but...
That recontextualization in that it was Charlotte that was being like, hey, make them go away.
Well, yeah, obviously it was her, but the idea that...
But Penny does actually want to...
Penny does want to talk to them, yeah.
Yeah.
Which is a fun parallel with Diane's whole thing of...
Oh, yeah.
You know.
Is there a way this can be
what,
good
can
damage?
I make, can I, yeah, can I find purpose out of my pain, you know?
Yeah. Bojack. Which, funnily enough, is also the thing that Bojack has tried to do in a lot of ways.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
All right, let's disassemble and decompartmentalize and piece back together Diane.
I love this episode. I love the way that they, like, so we're both keeping the tension up for, you know, the stuff at the end.
Mm-hmm.
Even though we can see ways in which this might be relevant.
Yeah. What brought Diane to actually come here?
Yeah. And if given that the formula for the show up until now is that when all like the bad stuff happens, at some point Diane writes about Bojack.
Mm-hmm.
Is that going to happen again this time, and what will that be like? So let's touch base with her and, you know, her own writing just something for herself and what that looks like. And I gotta say, this was such a wonderful deep dive into the feelings.
The psyche of a writer.
The psyche of a writer.
Yeah.
Because, goddamn, like, you know, anybody can be like, all right, yeah, I'm gonna write a bunch, and then, you know, you show that they've just written a very ornate the, right?
Just even the... me, person writing words to start the flow so that I can eventually start writing sentences that sound somewhat coherent, but, am I doing?
You know? Right, and then, it turns into you actually writing something that's, like, you know, has a decent bit of creativity to it of, you know, yeah, we can absolutely see the way in which it connects to, you know,
trauma
and or, you know, some wish fulfillment fantasy of I wish I was this person, right?
Literally trauma at the place at the mall.
Well,
you know?
Yeah, that too. Yeah, that. Yes.
Who is the one that's taking the money, you
right.
know?
And
that's a good theory.
Yeah, the way that, like, something as simple as just one little idea or question mm-hmm. can then make you be like...
I can make a whole story about that.
Yeah, exactly, right?
That's in a lot of ways my favorite part. Yeah, my favorite part about writing characters specifically is that if you can write a character, you can write a whole story.
Yeah.
Because when you get the character down, you then have to then ask questions about them that then spider out into other things that answer those questions, which right. then themselves have more questions. Mm-hmm. And then you have a world and a cast and a conflict and everything. There you go.
And so there were so many things that I loved that they got into here about the idea of being a writer. And I feel like there are almost too many to list out, but I'm going to try. One, the idea of being married to one idea for a story.
Yes.
That you don't have to do that.
Nope.
And in fact, that might be...
really bad.
Really bad and holding you back. Two, the idea that your story has to be some profound thing,
yes.
right? Otherwise,
yes.
it has no meaning. No, it doesn't have to be that. It can just be a fun story. And guess what? One of the most wonderful things that can happen is when in the middle of your simple story or whatever that's maybe just fun, just a good time, just a distraction from the hardships of life or whatever... oh, hey, some of that stuff ends up coming in through that naturally, mm-hmm. right?
Because
in
a way, just who you are.
Because of who you are in a way that people are then able to digest because they're along for the ride that's the fun, happy distraction from life, right?
Yeah.
And so, you know, and yet, because Diane has that artiste side of herself, right? She has no problem writing books for other people because then her identity isn't locked up in it, right?
Oh, my God.
She's just, then the words can just go onto the page.
Yep.
I have asked myself this question so many times of why is it that, like, I'm able to be super consistent with, like, the channel and things,
yet
then when it comes to writing, it's suddenly like, wait, hang on, how does that work again? Because, when you get your identity tied up in something, then suddenly your emotional state goes all over the place, and it's not just the simple, no, do the thing, put the words on paper, make the pages, you know?
Right. That's how a lot of these writers that pump it out really quickly just go.
And
they have no attachment identity-wise to any of these stories.
Right, and the whole, and then on
they
top
are
of
just
that,
a person. They are just, mm-hmm. just letting the fountain just go freely.
Well, exactly. And a lot of people then have this idea that it's like about the muse striking, right?
Oh,
and we
yeah.
kind of got to see a little bit of that here. But
sure.
the thing is that it's not something where, like, suddenly it strikes and then she writes a bunch.
Nope.
No, it's that she was writing, and a lot of the writing that she was doing, let's be real, was shit.
It was
right?
garbage.
And then in the middle of that, then suddenly, oh, hey, she actually starts to write something that's maybe good, that she can actually, like, work with.
Well, yeah, she does her thing of, I am enjoying overhearing the drama
mm-hmm.
going on
yeah.
in this little part of the world. Diane, maybe one of the things that's actually consistent about you, regardless of whether you're writing this with a purpose and you've
mm-hmm.
got this, like, big message that you're going for here, or it's something that's kind of your escapist fantasy of what you wish you could have become.
Sure.
Either way, whatever. The thing that you really like is kind of getting into other people's drama and being like, what's going on right here? This is spicy. This
yeah.
is interesting.
And that very thing that she kind of, like, it's a thing that she, I feel like, doesn't accept about herself, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, we get to see a lot of her insecurities and
right.
you know, basically lack of confidence or not necessarily good self-image
mm-hmm.
when we go into her headspace as she's writing, right?
Yeah.
But the thing is that very thing that maybe you don't like about yourself, maybe that's actually great. Maybe that's something that can that can be put to use in a way that even if you can't appreciate, someone else might, right? And the thing is that you don't know until somebody else reads it. And if you're too busy judging your own material to actually let other people see it, then, well, even if you do write, one, you probably won't, but even if you do, great, nobody gets to see it. Because the idea that you might, like, let's say you're chasing the idea of, oh, I want to give this kind of experience to people, right, that you had maybe, that's just kind of what it is for me. Thing is, you're never going to have that experience with your own writing.
Nope.
Fundamentally, you can't you created it.
You might, it's not, well, you.
Yeah, you might be able to appreciate it and be like, oh, I think this is really good. But it's not going to actually give you that same experience, right? Because it came from you.
Yeah, and so, and it's not that, you. So you have to let it go, well, go out there.
Yeah, you have to let it go. But almost more importantly, you are not actually the best metric for whether or not your book will be good.
Yeah.
And so when you are doing the thing that you're kind of supposed to do of seeing all the ways in which it doesn't work because you're trying to make it better, one, leave that for when you're in the editing stage. For first draft, get that out of here. That's not helpful, right?
No.
But then two, even when you are doing that, that's not going to mean that that's going to be what other people think, right? So you have to actually get other people to look at it and be like, hey, what do you think, right? Mm-hmm. So I feel like this definitely came from a place, you know, if you want to talk about writing a story about like damage and trauma and stuff, this is very much the writer that writes a thing that's about writing. You know, many people have done that before. Oftentimes I don't find it particularly engaging. This one, oh yeah, this fully puts it on display in a way that maybe people that aren't writers can appreciate, but also the people that are writers can be like, oh shit. Like all the ways,
exactly it. Yeah.
All the times that Diane was asked like, hey, how's the book going? Like that is a question that I answer completely differently depending on whether or not the person who asks it is a writer, you know? Because it's like, no, you don't just ask that question. You know, I know you're asking about a thing that I'm passionate about, and so you're trying to connect. But no, that's actually terrible because you're suddenly becoming a taskmaster. It's reminding me of the thing that's, you know, the yada, yada, yada.
Yeah.
But, yeah. So, this is great.
Yeah, I really love the way in which the story is basically giving Diane space to show her perspective on things. Because one of the things that's very evident within this episode here is that her perspective is tarnished. She has a very specific way of looking at things that is not real. She adds her own thing into it and then basically gets upset when people are not accepting things as the way that she sees them. It's very funny, but it's also very sad because when she ends up finding someone that actually likes what she does, she immediately jumps down their throat and is like, no, you're not allowed to like that. That's garbage. That's the thing that's worthless. But what's sad is that thing that she created that they liked is actually the part about herself that she likes.
Oh, sure.
In a lot of ways, it's the part about herself that she hates in another way because it's the I had to give that up for whatever reason. A lot of the actually fun things with this is Diane actually might have even become an unreliable narrator with regards to a lot of the things with her past, except for the fact that we did actually go to see her family situation.
We've got that bit of objectiveness to then inform this thing that very much is unreliable narrative.
Yes, I do think she was at the very least belittled a lot as a kid.
Absolutely.
She definitely had a not fun childhood, I would say. But I don't think she had like crazy abuse necessarily, like she like kind of seems to be implying and stuff with and the way that
that's
she drew it up here. So the idea that she then actually started having fun writing a story about the person that ended up going and having a fun little mini adventure as they sought to like find the truth of the matter of things. That sounds very adjacent to who you are right now, but less covered and tarnished with the cynicism of what's the point of it all because I can't do anything.
Right.
So it's freer, but it's also,
well,
I don't know.
So, here's my thought on it, right? It's a fantasy.
Yeah.
Because it's a fantasy, she is not valuing it. But the thing about fantasies is that you're talking about, you know, the ideal, right? And whether you're needing that ideal, that fantasy, as just a break or as something to remind yourself of, right? Because maybe it's very natural for those things that maybe are some of your good qualities.
It's touched with reality. It comes from a place of reality.
Right.
People think fantasy is then it's purely fictional. No. She's a, what did she say? She's like, and she's South Vietnamese. And it's like, picked that specifically because it's you know.
Yeah, like, this character is a self-insert. Yeah. That's fine. You know, like, we've definitely ragged on, like, self-insert characters before, but it's not that self-insert is bad. It's, you know, are you going to be intentional about the fact that this is a self-insert? Why is the fact that they're a self-insert important, right?
Yeah.
You know,
build the story around that.
Right. In this exploration with this character that doesn't exist, and because of that, she devalues it.
Yep.
She's able to then basically say, no, there are parts of me that are pretty awesome, right?
Mm-hmm.
And wouldn't that be great if that was all that I had to deal with? If I didn't also have all of these other things, all the rough edges of life and that life has you know, created within myself, that then basically make me say, this doesn't count, right? Mm-hmm. You know, this isn't good trauma, right?
Yeah.
You know, like, I can't actually make it be gold cracks. So, you know, then I'll just discount it, right? I'll question whether or not my experience was even legit, maybe mm-hmm. because it's not as extreme as it, you know, theoretically mm-hmm. could have been, where it then becomes very clear cut, right?
Right.
You know? But you still had an experience with life. There was
You're a human being, right? You have a story.
Yeah, exactly.
And the thing is that, yes, your exact story as it was might not be that interesting.
Yeah.
But that's okay, because you were never going to tell really your story specifically to begin with. That's the point I was bringing up with the unreliable narrator, was that she was trying to find extra things to make it spicier and add it to a thing there, because she couldn't just accept what story was. She was like, I need to grab something here, but writing actual details of it,
so this is where I, like, so the whole idea of, like, the memoir, and why I think it's such a good idea that she moved away from that, right?
Yes.
Is that you're not actually trying to communicate the events of your past.
Mm-hmm.
You're trying to communicate the feelings regarding the events of your past. Mm. And that is something that will not translate if you just spit out the details of your past. That's why fiction is important, because then we can have that layer of indirection.
Yep.
Yeah, of separation, where then we go into the, hey, here's this person who's having this great life.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe is very similar to you. Oh, but then maybe this thing happens that just sort of cracks that great life that they have, right? That might be a way to then draw attention to the feelings that you actually had regarding this event that maybe, you know, you're transposing into the story that no one would necessarily get if they just are getting all of the, you know, the mundane aspects of it or whatever, right? You know, this is highlighting, basically, you know?
Yeah.
And that's what you do in order to make sure that you can actually give the reader the experience, maybe, of what you felt from the stuff that happened in your past,
and
right?
So that it actually gets read. This is the other sad thing, is that you're asking to, you know, write a book, you know, at, you know, this point in time, Diane, when, sadly, you know, people just aren't reading as many books. You know, is that they're not a reader? Maybe a lucrative film adaptation, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
But the idea that if you're going to write a book for, you know, young girls to kind of give them that encouragement and stuff, you're going to need a layer of indirection, because they're not going to read a memoir of some random author.
Right. And even if they do, will they be emotionally vulnerable in order to go to those dark places that you want to go? Because they might not be, because life is already hard enough as it is. Right?
No, it's just, I'm not even being that nice. I'm just saying simple marketing, no.
Oh, yeah, no, the eyeballs will not be on it.
No one of your intended audience will read it. It'll probably be read by other writers.
Sure.
Probably. You know.
One of the, there was a lady that was like a higher up administrative person at a publishing company that used to come by my workplace.
Mm-hmm.
And I would ask her sometimes, like, you know, after I, like, gave them their stuff, you know, like, little bits for, you know, advice.
Yeah, yeah.
And I was like, if you could give me one piece of advice, right, that you think would be helpful, you know, what would it be? And she said, literary fiction doesn't sell.
Yeah.
And that was her bit of advice. Literary being more the kind of stuff that Diane's wanting to get into.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
Even if you do pull off the feat of being able to go to that dark place within yourself and from within that dark place where you don't want to write and you don't want to do all of these things, you still manage to actually make something that is legitimately really good, rather than just being drivel, people still won't necessarily be interested in it. But if you do something that's maybe fun, maybe you'll get some of that, you know, that stuff that you wanted to have in the book in the first place.
Or maybe, Diane, also, you'll get to a point where people then be listening more specifically to the things you have to say about this.
Sure.
And you can give commentary on the places that, you mm-hmm. know, what drove you? What was your inspiration for writing this book?
Yeah.
And then you have these people mm-hmm. showing up to be like, I'm listening with bated breath because I was really attached to, you know, this character here.
Right.
And I now really want to know, like, what woman was the one that, you know, birthed that character?
Right.
Oh, that was your story? Whoa. Oh, okay. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that's something that's resonated a lot with me is when I meet creatives, I don't really care as much about the asking them about the, what were your thoughts around, you know, page 267 of this
sure.
thing here? But more about, like, hey, what was the headspace you were in? What was the emotional space you were in when you, like, wrote this? Like, what was the thing that inspired this? What were the things that just inspired the story? Like,
yeah.
those kinds of things about getting to know the person there. Because I feel like when I look at a writer or a creative of any kind, I need to know that there were those moments where they felt the, oh, that's it. This is good. Or, oh, mm-hmm. God, this is shit. Or,
yeah.
oh, wow, I'm just droning on, I'm trying.
Right.
And kind of hearing more about that human experience is then the point that gets me all fired up to then go and be a creative as well. So
yeah.
rather than the details of, you know, what was that story about, or, mm-hmm. you know, what have you.
Also, I will say, and this is not coming from me. This is something that I heard Brando Sando say, actually. That
Brandon Sanderson.
Yeah, Brandon yes. Sanderson. The difference between the points where the muse has struck and you're like, oh, and you know, the fountain is flowing. Yeah, exactly. It's effortless. Versus the, this is a slog. I don't want to be doing this, but I'm going to keep putting words on page.
Mm-hmm.
Most of the time, the readers can't tell.
Nope.
Right? Like,
definitely not.
So don't worry.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But if you want to write, write.
Yeah. And what I really liked about this as well was that, boyfriend here, ask the real question, do you really want to write this book?
Mm-hmm.
Because I feel like a lot of our creative force for things can come about because of, like, self-deception, like, or it can be thwarted because of self-deception. Basically, the idea that Diane really doesn't want to write the memoir book. Like, she doesn't.
Right.
She was even, like, depressed about this, of the idea of, well, then if I do that, then what's next?
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Right. And I have to write this, not
right.
I want to.
Right. Meaning that she is not enjoying the process.
Mm-hmm.
And every creative out there will tell you, if you don't enjoy the process of what you're doing, meaning the ups, the downs, the valleys,
mm-hmm.
the mids, everything
right.
in between it there, get out.
Yeah.
You are not doing what you're meant to be doing, basically.
There will be those downs, right?
Yes.
So don't worry when those happen. But if you can't be in a place where you can basically be like, this is something that I take in stride.
Right.
This is, you know, like maybe stepping away is a good idea. Then you
mm-hmm.
can realize, like, oh, is this something that I actually want to do?
Rediscover
yeah. that love for it, whatever.
Right. And when I say that, meaning like, yeah, like you're saying, it's not that you have to enjoy the process 100% of the time. But if you don't have the capacity to look at the process and appreciate it for what it is,
mm-hmm.
like then, yeah, you got to get out of that. Like, you just got to.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I just love that we're actually seeing the process being put on full display here.
Yes.
Whereas for most of Diane's journey in the show, we don't actually get that much time in the process, or we haven't until this season, I feel like.
Mm-hmm.
So this was a nice part two or part three, I guess, of Diane's journey of dealing with depression, dealing with her panic attacks, dealing with her identity, and dealing with where she wants to apply all this gumption and passion and purpose into something, but feels like it's all kind of pointless. And I feel like we as people go through that, even if you're not a creative type. The idea
right.
of having moments where you're like, wait, but this is going to end too. This is going to have a moment where it's going to be, you know, judged by people, and
sure.
will it all have been worth it, you know, in the end?
Mm-hmm.
It's the, like, well, no, that's the wrong question, basically. Like, it's not,
right.
it's not really
decide
about
it's worth
that.
It in the process rather
yeah,
than being
yeah.
something that's contingent upon some, you know, nebulous, not measured response. You
right,
know?
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Also, stay on your meds because Oh, hey, even in this situation where Diane went off the meds and everything, meds aren't always something that can be gotten back on quickly.
Nope.
Sometimes it takes several weeks or maybe even, you know, over a month that for them to fully kick in.
Unironically, that was the one part in this episode that kind of pissed me off was that she got off the meds, had the, you know, symptoms.
Yep.
And I was just like, oh, cool. They're actually showing the symptoms here. This is going to be rough. Yep. Next day, I'm feeling a lot better. I'm like, that's not how it works.
I'm
glad for you, Diane.
It's a, you know, 25-minute episode or whatever, and we also have all of the other stuff, you know,
yeah, in addition to the along. Diane thing.
Yes, but, you know, just PSA. You know, if that's something that you have as just a constant of your life moving forward, yes, that can be scary, and that dependency can, you know, be frustrating and all sorts of other things. But, you know,
don't if just it's helping, jump off your meds
don't worry about it. Yeah.
All of a sudden, like.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And if you want to try something like that out, talk to your provider because then they can basically be like, okay, if you know, if you think this is something maybe you don't need anymore.
Yeah, there's so many good resources out there.
Like we can go through that as like a full process, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah.
All right, big spice bomb. This episode, we saved it all the way till this point in the discussion. Charlotte.
Yeah.
She said my mistakes. During that part as well, which is true.
Mm-hmm.
She did make a mistake in basically letting Bojack live here.
Yep.
But.
And also.
But.
I guess not telling the husband anything about what happened.
No. That's the part that's really fucking just messed up about this. She cares more. This is a very, I think this is very like a nuclear take here. But it seems like she cares more about saving face than she does about what her daughter wants.
And or at the very least.
That's the nice way of saying it. Because what she's saying is that you don't know what's best for you.
Sure.
And in a lot of ways, she's right. She has the added value of age, perspective, and a little bit more, you know, wisdom thus in that regard.
And also
experience.
Like, she had that point where she did live in L.A., right? Like,
no, totally. You know, totally. So she has the experience there. But I'm saying that there's a way of looking at this where it's the, hey, yes, protect your daughter.
Yeah.
Of course. But you already kind of fucked that up a little bit. So are you more scared about the ways in which your daughter's going to go through emotional turmoil out of the desire to be a, you know, like in some ways kind of a heroine here to stand up and do something about this?
Yep.
That's really courageous. And you should be, I think she did kind of applaud her courage in that regard.
But it's the, oh no, I don't think she's actually counting the cost. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
But do you think that it's more that I don't think she's counting the cost versus the, oh, I'm a little bit more worried about.
So I think, and that's where I think the comparison of how much she cares about the things, I'm not going to go that far, but it's the thing of where the well's contaminated, right?
Well is contaminated.
You know,
okay.
She absolutely cares about her daughter. What she's doing here absolutely is something where she's doing a lot of it for her daughter. But that's not the entirety of what the situation is, right?
Right.
And because she is also one dealing with this herself.
Yep. Thank you.
She
this
is
what I was
compromised.
Uh-huh.
She does not have somebody to basically give her feedback.
Yep.
And so the spiciest thing from this episode for me is not the fact that Charlotte was the one who reached out to Bojack, even though her daughter didn't want her to, and all that stuff. It's the fact that the husband knew nothing about any of this. That all of this shit happened, and basically Charlotte made the decision that it needed to be kept a secret, which then that makes it so that the distance that maybe Penny has from Charlotte makes way more sense, because she's saying basically, you can deal with this with me, but not with Dad. And if you ever have issues with me, since this was basically my, you know, previous friend, close friend that basically lived here and all of that stuff, well, guess what? You know, you don't necessarily have anywhere to deal with that because I'm the only person that you can process this whole situation with.
Right. Yeah. So that's thank you. That is part of the thing that adds into this.
Right.
Is
now,
the,
okay, go for it.
Well, it's just the idea that she's like, this is I think it's a nuclear take. This is why I don't think I'm right necessarily, but I think it needs to be said is that what she's effectively done.
Mm-hmm.
Is taken her daughter's pain, and at the very least, isolated her.
Yep.
To where she can't talk to anybody about this.
Mm-hmm.
She said she just got over her panic attacks, which is like, okay, cool. So we're seeing progress. And from that perspective, it's the, yeah, I don't want to see you go back into this.
Totally.
But the, I lied to my husband, you know, said there was nothing going on. So it's, you know, he doesn't know anything.
Mm-hmm.
Kept her specifically from telling her husband. Then when she clearly has this anxiousness of wanting to talk about it and has been keeping also the secret kind of this whole time that she's kept evidence of this stuff and wants to talk about it but can't tell her mom that, this is manipulator stuff.
Oh, yeah.
This is the kind of thing of where she's actively suppressing the... And I kind of love the idea here as well. She doesn't live with you anymore.
Right.
She's an adult. She's off on her own now.
Yep.
But...
you're still trying to basically keep control over their life.
Yeah, which, yeah. She's trying to bring her back into
with
the...
With all of the best intentions, right? The whole thing of keeping the...
I don't throw best intentions into this. I'm basically saying that's my nuclear take, is I don't think she has her best intentions at mind. I think she has some intentions
I'll put
good.
It this way. I think she thinks she has the best intentions.
No, I think she... I don't... Yes, but I don't care about her thinks she has the best intentions. I'm thinking that there's a percentage of her that is scared about her marriage falling apart.
Sure.
Because the truth is going to come out.
Oh, yeah.
Two, the way in which she's going to get dragged through the mud as well.
Yep.
Because one of the things that's very important to this whole thing here is that her daughter, minor... had an adult male being brought into the premises that was your, basically your ex equivalent there.
Sure.
Kept him in this situation. And then after the event happened, the criminal basically event happened, she did not seek to press charges or do anything to Bojack because he's a friend.
Oh, sure.
Wait, there's so the possibility whose side are you on, you know?
There's all the ways in which this could potentially look bad, given that it's her daughter.
Right.
I think there's... I don't think it'll necessarily look that bad.
No, but I think that's why she said things like, you won't have control of the story.
Yeah.
You know, I have mistakes. I made mistakes, too. Like, it's...
Oh, yeah.
It's very practical, but I think it still needs to be said that ultimately... It's not your story, Charlotte. It's hers.
Well, right.
She experienced this.
Well, and that's why she's, to some of Charlotte's credit, she is not attempting to convince Penny to not go to the reporters. Granted, she tried that, and it didn't work. So it's more just, it's probably that she just realizes that she can't actually keep her daughter from doing that.
I think
she
literally did, in the conversation, say... You don't want to do this. Trust me.
Right.
You're meaning she actively didn't restrain her daughter, or like?
Yeah, I mean, it's not that she would restrain her daughter or anything like
that.
No,
but I mean, like, the kind of thing of, like, you cannot tell them, like,
making
the decision for her. Well, yeah, because then she would hurt her relationship with her daughter.
Well, right, and also it wouldn't end up working. But, yeah, I think this will be... We haven't gotten a lot from Charlotte in the show because the amount of time that she was actually present was very little.
Very little.
So this is good characterization.
Yeah.
And even giving her the full benefit of the doubt, that maybe the reason why she didn't tell the husband and was like, we shouldn't tell him, is because his defining characteristic has been...
He's kind of dopey and dumb.
Yeah. You know, and so the idea that, like, hey, we'll handle this, maybe he wouldn't be...
Yeah, I understand that there's elements where a situation can be so extreme that for their benefit, you keep a secret from them. I think, though, that
that's a mistake.
Situation here, that's a horrendous mistake.
Yeah. And you know, so, yeah, like,
This will explode.
I do really like that the show is showing this side of things because... Well, Bojack is our main character, right? You know, why make it be about the person that caused the harm? Why not let's show the ways in which there is the rippling consequences of that harm that goes beyond the single degree of separation, right? You know, beyond just the, oh, Penny having panic attacks and all of that stuff, right? But the, oh yeah, if this turns into something where because Charlotte decided to keep it from the husband and the husband finds out and the family falls apart or something, right? Because, you know, Penny decides, I need to do this, right?
Yep.
Well, shit.
Well,
you know?
Shit. Like, there you go.
Yeah.
I love this as well, like you're saying, because there's so much nuance here now. Bojack has like a very specific list of really fucked up things that he did, and this is like right at the top. Like this is this is like directly at the top. Like maybe I don't know. I don't want to rate things at that point. It's just
he's
gross.
Done a bunch of messed up stuff, and but, you know, but there's
the idea,
more.
But
right?
The idea that the show is like, oh, we're gonna potentially like paint a very specific like bad number on Charlotte here, like a oh. You could look at this from a perspective where what's her end game here with a daughter who is going to go to the reporters no matter what you do. She then goes to Bojack and is like, need you to figure this out, basically.
Right.
Meaning that she would control her daughter if she could.
Right. But she
can't. But she can't.
Yep.
So therefore, she does kind of something that's like, hey, I think it's actually a pretty reasonable phone call as far as things go there. It just speaks to the way in which she does things primarily through secrecy and potential manipulation rather than honest communication.
Right. She is not doing a good thing, but the show has done a very good job of making us understand exactly why.
Oh yeah.
She's doing all the things. That
I like that she called Bojack, and I actually think she made the right call in a lot of ways. Yep. But the reason why she's here in this situation in a lot of ways is because probably she didn't let, is it Penny?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Get into a situation where she was able to process this enough, basically.
Sure. Yeah.
Now, how the hell are you supposed to process this? I don't know. Mm-hmm. It's a nightmare. So, well,
and I wouldn't be surprised if,
maybe don't isolate her.
Maybe don't isolate her. I wouldn't be surprised though if part of the reason of why she's like, oh, maybe the isolation or maybe other things, but it's the Charlotte carries guilt because she let Bojack stay here. Right?
Oh yeah, no, you know, no, 100%.
Right.
Yeah.
And so then it's the, you know, this is kind of on me, and so I need to fix this, right?
Mm-hmm.
But in doing so, she's actually like making the situation worse.
Right, and yet that's just true. She's right. This is Bojack's fault,
mm-hmm.
but you carry a small, you know, percentage of it as well. And I don't like the way in which, you know, we revealed basically some kind of just some really like upsetting things about her character, and that she would rather basically keep this all a secret with regards to family than actually give her daughter more opportunities to process it. But maybe her daughter is going to, you know, therapy and getting some really good, you know, emotional and mental care and stuff like this. So
right, that could absolutely be a thing.
I think realistically that's probably happening,
but this is the beginning of an arc of the story. Well,
so
actually, I think there's a decent chance that she isn't, because if it never came up in therapy that, like, you know, oh, yeah, I haven't told my dad about any of this. Like, maybe that would still just be a decision that they stuck with, you know? But, like,
she would have confidentiality privileges.
Oh, no, totally. I'm more talking about from the standpoint of Penny having somebody that could tell her, like, you should have more than just your mom to talk about this and or more than just me, you know? Right, like as a therapist,
I don't know. That's a part where I would...
As things become relevant, we will be shown them, so...
That's true, But the way they used this storyline to parallel Diane and Penny here was...
Yeah.
Oh, boy. I'm terrified and excited. But y'all, thank you so much for watching this episode's reaction and discussion. If you want to see the next episode's reaction and discussion right now, though, go check out the link in the description below for our Patreon. You get an early access there. You can watch full-length timer reactions there, and all this comes with Discord access, so you can chat with us in the community there about this show, about animated shows in general. And also be sure to check out our Twitch channel. See if any of that interests you, we'll see you there. But until then, we're Semblance of Sanity. I'm Caleb.
I'm Jacob.
And we'll see you all next time.